Thanks. And it's a real honor for me to be here and to give the first lecture in honor and in memory of Michelle. I first met Michelle when she was a postdoc at the Shepp Center. And there was a whole cadre of really great postdocs that year when she came. And there was something different, though, about Michelle and her enthusiasm and her energy. And plus, she was focused on kids, which of course made me gravitate to her right away. But even beyond that, there was something unique and special about her. And we worked together on different projects. And although I think a mentorship relationship is one not just where the mentor shares with the mentee, but importantly where the mentee shares with the mentor. And Michelle, because of her interest and emphasis on chronic disease, and as we just heard about, her emphasis on the idea of health care and the importance of making sure that the services that are provided fit within a human paradigm, taught me a lot about the issues that I was even already starting to address in my young career. And then as her disease progressed, we reconnected when she became more involved in workforce studies, because that became an interest of mine later in my career also. And it was through her initiative that we reconnected and eventually began to work together on a project that was finally accepted for publication just months before her death, and then subsequently published. And throughout her last stages of illness, we only had email contact back and forth. And what was remarkable was her knowing what I knew about her condition, her level of drive and determination never diminished. And from reading her blog, her drive and determination on behalf of her family never diminished, and her drive and determination on behalf of trying to make a difference and do something for children never diminished. And so it was really very meaningful to me when I believe it was Morris who contacted me and asked me to what I consider coming here and doing this, and without hesitation, I wanted to, because any way that I can be a part of something that honors Michelle is something that I wanted to be a part of, because I think through her work and her legacy, she's certainly made a difference in my life, and I'm guessing from just what we heard today and from the others with whom I've spoke, she's made a difference way beyond just the people that knew her personally, but also the people who've had the privilege of reading her work and learning about her story. So I thank y'all for allowing me to be a part of this, because a part of the time that I spent in North Carolina for the years that I was here, I had the privilege of being a part of Michelle's time in North Carolina. So, with that in mind, I'd like to move on now to, I think, something that Michelle, I think, would find quite interesting, would be how things are playing out right now across the country with regard to what we all hear a lot about is the aging of America and what's going on. But we don't spend a lot of time thinking about, is that having an impact on the other aspects of our society? So, a few disclaimers before we start. I am not a senior. I am not a child, although my wife would probably disagree with me at times. I am aging, as much as I hate to admit that. But I'm not trying to foment age warfare, because I think that's where we have to be very cautious. And we can't look at some of these issues as one versus the other. What I believe we have to do is, as society, begin to make conscious decisions regarding resource allocation, because these decisions are happening either passively, mostly passively and not actively, every single day. And they happen without deliberate thought, and they happen without us really understanding the consequences of some of the decisions or some of the processes that are unfolding as a result of the changing demographics of this country. And I hope that a better informed society will make the best decisions. And to become, and again, it's not that I'm not here to tell you what the decision should be. I'm not here as a child advocate. I'm here with a goal of trying to lay out the situation and have us begin the debate of deciding what we as a society want to do. And to do that, we have to understand what's happening now and what will continue to happen if we go on our certain path or the continue our current path. And if we continue our current path and we decide that from a knowledgeable standpoint, then that's okay. That's a societal decision. It's an informed societal decision. I just want us to make sure we make informed decisions. So I'm going to go through, I'm struggling here because I have both of these and I'm going to end up wanting to point to things. So I don't know how I'm going to do it, but we'll just work it out as we get there. So I'm going to talk about past and current spending patterns in the United States. I'm going to talk about Medicaid and Medicaid spending and its impact on state budgets. I'm going to talk about some of the current trends in private sector financing and the delivery of healthcare, some of the ways in which our society currently values or the mechanisms we use to value healthcare, and at the end, I'm going to put out for your consideration and your thought some potential future directions and some policy suggestions to deal with, as a society, the resource allocations as we watch the aging of America. This says, so does anyone else feel their needs aren't being met? I think in this kind of day and age with healthcare, this is sort of the way we all approach, or everyone looks at the situation right now. So it's not that anyone's winning and other people are losing. I think everybody kind of feels their needs aren't being met. But the solution isn't just to, you know, toss them asunder. So this is really the crux of the issue. And there's an invisible, I can't walk out too far because there's an invisible fence that I'll have feedback if I do. Is there a pointer on here?
Yes.
Ah, Eureka. Okay, I'm going to go with this one because it's brighter than this one. So this is really the crux of the issue. The yellow line is the population of the United States, the number of kids in the United States 0 to 14 years of age, roughly from the early 1960s to last year. And the blue triangles is the number of people in the United States over 14 years of age from the early 1960s until today. Now, what you can see here is that there's roughly the same number of kids today as there was in the early 1960s. Now, they're different children, but they're the same number of kids. And what we can see is back in the early 1960s, kids made up around 40% of the population in the United States. Today, they make up around 24%. So a really big difference. We've had a dramatic shift in the proportion of our population that are children. Remember, there are no fewer children in the United States, but their proportion of the population has diminished markedly. Oh. And we'll talk about why this has happened and whether or not this is going to continue to happen. But ultimately, this is the aging of America. And this trend for the foreseeable future is going to continue. We may have a little bit higher number of kids, some census projections going forward, but in essence, it's roughly within a 5% range, kind of a flat line. So now let's talk just a little bit, because we're all different stages here, the healthcare finance in the United States, just a little tiny primer. Healthcare, depending on who you talk to and whether or not the GDP has contracted 6% or 7% in the last quarter, it's roughly somewhere between 15 and 17% of our GNP. In the public sector, we have a few specific areas of healthcare financing. There's Medicare, which takes care of people 65 and older, people with end-stage renal disease. We have Medicaid, we'll be talking a lot about that, which is poor kids, people who are blind and disabled, and also the elderly in long-term care facilities. There's also some state programs that vary state by state, and there's also some public sector research funding, whether it be from the NIH, the CDC, or other federal agencies. There's private sector funding for healthcare. There's private insurance, we hear a lot about that. There's private sector research funding, and there's also private sector product development. And I will demonstrate the differences across each of these funding sectors with regard to the way in which that last graph that I showed you is playing out in terms of the way in which all of those areas of healthcare financing are trending right now and what the potential is for their trends in the future. So let's just take a step back in time. This is probably before many of you were born, 1987 to 1998, the students in the room. But if we look at per capita spending for health, for the year that I left Chapel Hill, which was 1998, the decade before that, inflation adjusted. In 1987, inflation adjusted healthcare spending for a child less than 6 years of age was around $1,000 a year. For someone greater than 65 years of age was $3,800 a year. By 1998, inflation adjusted, we actually had lower per capita spending for children less than 6 years of age and almost a doubling of spending per capita for people greater than 65 years of age. And again, remembering that graph I showed you where the proportion of the people who weren't children was rising in the United States and that gap was widening, we had not only a change in the number of people who were less than 6 years of age or greater than 65 years of age, but we also had a difference in the per capita spending for each of those. So it's almost an additive effect of what was going on. Now let's jump forward and let's look at personal healthcare spending now in 2004, which is the latest year that I could get the what I would consider reliable data. And if we looked at annual spending per capita in this line, we see that annual spending per capita for those 0 to 17 years of age is around $2,600 a year. For 18 to 64 year of age people, it's around $4,500 a year. And for those greater than 65, the fastest growing segment of our population, we see that annual per capita spending is almost $15,000 per year. And when we multiply that by the current distribution of population in the United States, we find the total distribution of personal healthcare spending in the US, about 13% of our total spending is in the pediatric age range, about 52% in the 18 to 64 year age range, and 35% of our total healthcare spending right now is in the greater than 65 year age range. Again, the fastest growing segment of our population. So that segment of the population growing the fastest, costing the most by far. So how is that then translating into where our new monies are going? Let's jump ahead to now the modern era, last year. Changes in the fiscal year 06-07 with regard to changes in spending for children and for adults. The GDP, probably the last year that it grew in 06-07, grew at a rate of 2.3%. The children's budget that year, and by the children's budget, I'm including not just children's health care, but also the two largest expenditures domestically for children, which are actually tax credits. They're not cash outlays, but they're tax credits. That grew by 0.7%. It also includes Medicaid, sorry. And the adult entitlements, only including Medicaid, Medicare, and Social Security, grew by 5.2%. So again, we have the GDP growing by a little over 2%. The children's allocation, the children's growth, about a third of the growth within GDP, and the growth in adult entitlements, a little over double the growth in the GDP. Now, again, I'm not saying this is right, and I'm not saying it's wrong. What I'm trying to do is help to illustrate, just simply by the trends that are occurring now, by the proportional spending formulas that are in place that are made up by the differences in population, this is the direction and this is the way things are going right now. If we as a society decide that's what we want to do, then that's what we should do. But as we continue to walk down this path, we'll see that there's actually significant shifts in resources that are taking place, both in the terms of actual expenditures as well as where the growth of expenditures are, that is simply based on the changes in the proportion of our population. Some people might argue that proportional spending is appropriate. You know, that of course, if we have a greater proportion of our society, We should be spending more in that arena. The danger here is that even though, like I said before, we have a smaller proportion of children, we don't have any fewer children than we had back in 1963. And again, this just illustrates that point. We don't have any fewer kids, they're just a smaller proportion of the population. So when we look at the children's share of domestic federal spending, let's now look at some, not only where we were, but let's look at projections about if we continue on the current paths we're going, where will we end up? In 1960, the children's share of domestic federal spending, and again, the largest programs for kids are the child tax credit, the earned income tax credit, and Medicaid. So when we talk about children's domestic spending, these are the top three areas where children's spending occurs in the current federal budget. In 1960, children's spending made up around 20.2% of all domestic federal spending. By 2007, that had fallen to roughly 16.2% of all domestic spending. And if we play out the forecast going to the future with the changes or continuing changes in the demography of America and a continually growing proportion of our federal of our population being elders and the spending, as I showed you, that goes along with that, we'll have children's share of domestic federal spending decrease to around 13.8% by the year 2018. And if we want to look at that graphically, unfortunately, the yellow doesn't show up so much here, but this blue line is federal spending on adult entitlements. This would be Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid for adults. The yellow line is the spending for children that I spoke about before, and we see from 1960, back when children made up around 40% of the population, we had the domestic spending on adults at around 22% and children at about 20%. This, if you notice the slope of the lines, is actually very similar to what I showed you in the changes in demography, in the changes in the proportion of the population being either children or adults. So it makes sense that the spending patterns do the same, and we see a drop from around 20% of domestic spending to around 16% for kids by 2007, and almost a doubling of domestic spending on adults to around 50% of all domestic spending. If we go out even further now and look at the trends to 2018, which is what I showed you the numbers, just to look at it in a graph, you can see for the adults, we go from the 49.1% we saw on the last slide out to 59%. As again, a greater proportion of the population ages, and a greater proportion of that aging population is in the higher cost arena, the 65 and older group. And when we look at proportion, we again see, just as we see a change in the proportion of the population being kids and a decrease, we see a drop from around 18% down to around 16% or so of the total domestic federal spending. Again, the graphs paralleling or looking very similar to the graph we saw with regard to the change in populations. Now you might say, well, it's because seniors are poor, and that's why more money is spent on seniors, because they're so often in poverty. But if we look at real per capita spending for children, this is in 2005, we see per capita spending on kids was $4,700. Per capita spending on the elderly, again, this is federal dollars, was around $20,000. And then when we look at the poverty rates, though, we see something interesting, kind of counterintuitive to what I think many people in the United States appreciate, is that poverty rates, or the adjusted poverty rates for kids in this country is 13%, and the adjusted poverty rates for the elderly, again, this is 65 and older, is around 6.7%. So we can't say that we're spending more on elders in social services and in healthcare because they have a higher poverty rate. It's simply actually tied to the changing demography of the United States and the growing proportion of the United States that's made up of people within this age range and the fact that they happen to cost more. And our spending is set up so that that's the way it happens. So, I believe these trends are going to accentuate. either at the rate of the change in the proportion of population, or perhaps even further, or even quicker. Why? Well, we certainly have the retirement of the baby boom generation. Now, maybe they're going to put off retirement a little bit because all their 401ks have, you know, fallen apart, but it's not going to be put off for that long. And that's going to, again, create a bulge in much of domestic spending. We also have the political power of the growing elder population. It's no secret that elders vote, and that's great, and I think that's positive. And again, I'm not saying it's wrong we're spending that money or that that's where the proportion of resources go. I just think we need to realize what's going on so it doesn't happen without anyone understanding or appreciating the directions that things are going. So because elders vote, that has a big impact in how we apportion money. And children don't. I mean, it's just kind of the way the world works. I think there's also a political imperative at times for proportional spending because it just makes sense. If we have more people in one age group or one demographic or whatever it might be, people intuitively think, well, that's where those allocation of resources ought to go in a proportional sense. We just have to decide, is that really what we want to do? And what are the consequences, both positive and negative, of doing that? The other thing that's going to accentuate these trends is that the highest cost per person, as I said before, is in the elderly, and that will be especially as the baby boom generation retires, as people continue to live longer, we're going to see that cost per person, those people in the highest cost per person arena, continue to rise, and that will have even a greater effect on this moving forward. So now let's talk about how children are faring in Medicaid. Because a lot of times we think, oh, Medicaid, that's there to take care of kids. That's a kids program. But in fact, you have to be very careful when you're looking at Medicaid and realize that things aren't always necessarily the way that they seem. Now, this is a little pie chart that shows you Medicaid enrollees by age nationally in 2005. And I apologize, this should say 0 to 18, not 1 to 18. And we see that actually the majority of enrollees in the Medicaid program are kids. Those that are 19 and over, people would say, well, I didn't know that there were grown-ups in Medicaid. Well, those are blind and disabled and seniors in long-term care facilities. So it's true that there's more children enrolled in Medicaid than any other demographic in the United States. What many people don't realize, though, is where the Medicaid expenditures are. And in fact, less than 25% or less than a quarter of all Medicaid spending is on kids. The vast majority of Medicaid spending is on adults, either the blind and disabled or seniors in long-term care facilities. But oddly, whenever we hear about the crisis in Medicaid, we always hear about more kids in poverty. But that's not where the bulk of Medicaid expenditures are taking place. And that's not where the bulk of Medicaid expenditures are growing. So, what does that translate into in real dollars? In a federal sense, for FY04, the expenditures on kids in Medicaid was $57 billion. For those 19 to 64 years of age, and again, most of those are blind and disabled adults, $121 billion. And for those greater than 65 years of age, close to $70 billion. So kids, as I showed you before, make up less than 25%, less than a quarter of all Medicaid expenditures. And there's actually less Medicaid expenditure on kids than on seniors. But again, not something we often think about in terms of Medicaid and Medicaid policy. Where's been the growth in the Medicaid budget? Again, let's take a walk down memory lane and go back to 1978, to again, the year that I left North Carolina, which is where I base so much of my data on. It's like a different stage in my life. So from 1978 to 1998, the annual growth for the kids spending part of Medicaid was 2.8%. For the adult blind and disabled was 3.7%. And again, the fastest growing portion of Medicaid expenditures even 10 years ago was in the elders, where there was 5% growth on an annual basis. And again, if we look at expenditures, again, it should say 0 to 18, I apologize, not 1 to 18 here. If we look at the expenditures of Medicaid by age and year, the pink being 19 and over, the blue being 0 to 18, we see a graph that looks strangely similar to the graph I showed you about the changing demographic and changing population of the United States, and that the fastest growing arena for Medicaid expenditures and the most Medicaid expenditures are in the adult age range, not in the kids' age range. So I know many of you are thinking, so what? Big deal. Who cares? If that's where the need is, then that's where we should spend. But I would posit there's some things we need to think about. First of all, states take on roughly a 50% share of all Medicaid expenditures. North Carolina, not unlike many states, is having some budget problems right now. Michigan, where I live, has some real budget problems right now. And states have to respond to budget pressures. And when they respond to budget pressures, as I'll show you in a second, they respond in a variety of different ways. One of the biggest crises for states across the country right now is Medicaid expenditures. They're ballooning. And the initial reaction people have is, we have to do something about all the poor kids that are on Medicaid, and we either need to cut eligibility, we need to cut the benefit package, or whatever. But as I showed you before, and I'll go into greater detail in a moment, that's not where the greatest growth of Medicaid expenditures are. Also, there's a limited pool of resources for Medicaid. Even though it's an entitlement, a state has to put up half the dough, roughly, to be able to draw down their federal match. So states, as much as they can, try to adjust their Medicaid programs to be able to control those expenses. And again, as I said, the cost increases have been across all of the eligibility categories, but the expenditures haven't been increasing evenly. We see a faster rate of growth in certain aspects of, or certain populations that are covered by Medicaid, specifically the elderly and the adult blind and disabled, than we do for kids. And because the most expensive groups covered by Medicaid are also the ones that are growing most rapidly in terms of population, the demographic changes are going to create a continued budget crisis for states that's going to go beyond just simply what's happening right now with the current economic crisis that we're all facing. So, what's the impact of limited resources on the states? Well, the states, when you're faced with a budget shortage, try to control costs. Like, that's what we all expect of our legislators. And in Medicaid, that tends to begin with changes in eligibility. You might change the poverty rate at which you allow children or pregnant women to become eligible. You can change the benefit packages and change the payments that are made with regard to insurers. And you can also change provider reimbursement. And those changes, however, can have a significant impact on patient access, whether that be for dental care or whether it be for health care. And one of the most important issues that surrounds that is that many times we have adult providers complain about Medicare reimbursement. Those of you who study this, of course, know that Medicaid reimbursement is already a fraction of what Medicare reimbursement is. And as states cut back Medicaid reimbursement further, there'll be a further erosion of access or of providers either in dental care or in health care actually providing or willing to provide those Medicaid services. Another way that states will continue to control costs or attempt to control costs, if their costs increase in Medicaid and they're only able to limit it to a certain degree, they're also going to have to cut back in other areas. Sometimes that may be on roads, sometimes it may be on different aspects of health care. Many states, and we'll go over this in detail in a second, have cut back significantly on their funding of immunization programs, likely because many of them are attempting to save money from those increasing Medicaid expenditures. Again, to remind you, the increase or the fastest growing rates of increase in Medicaid expenditures are on the blind and disabled and on the elderly. But the places where states look to make those cutbacks, most often across the country, are not within those age groups. They're either in other age groups of Medicaid eligibility or in other health programs that affect other segments of the population. So How have states responded specifically to the increase in costs in Medicaid? 10 states now charge Medicaid premiums or have waivers to charge Medicaid premiums to families with incomes as low as 101% of the poverty level. So then this is for kids' coverage, not for adults' coverage. 34 states have imposed premiums or enrollment fees for any child health coverage. And 21 states have now implemented co-payments for prescription drugs for children on Medicaid. Again, not the place where the greatest cost increases are taking place, but the places politically where states are able to control their costs in this growing category of expenditures. So what does this turn out to be? Specifically, in the state health, for state health insurance, the states that are charging, as I said before, the premiums. States at 101% of the poverty level can charge are charging currently anywhere from $8 to $40 a month for Medicaid enrollment. Up to for the people that are up to 151% of the federal poverty level, premium rates of $10 to $75 a month for families. And for those families at 200% of the poverty level, 10 to even up to, in one state, $250 per month in premiums for Medicaid coverage for children. What other kind of responses have these states had? I mentioned immunizations a second ago. Well, between 2004 and 2006, 10 states have limited or reduced the provisions of vaccines to underinsured children in their states. 7 states for new vaccines, meaning that if you show up at the health department wanting a particular vaccine, in 7 of these states around the country now, there is no state funding. If they're not eligible for the Vaccines for Children federal program, there is no state funding for those childhood immunizations. And in 3 states, there's no state funding whatsoever for any childhood immunizations, that those have been cut back. So that's in response to state budget pressures, not necessarily because of increased children's expenditures, but that's the places, because it's a zero-sum game in the budget world, that they have to cut back. What about SCHIP? That's kind of the saving grace in all of this. Well, states have actually been quite resourceful in using SCHIP money to cover non-children. 4 states cover childless adults with SCHIP money. 11 states cover the parents of children. 11 states cover pregnant women. And overall, around the country, 10% of all the covered lives on the SCHIP program, the State Child Health Insurance Program, are adults. And as you know, in 2008, there was a veto of the expansion of the SCHIP program, but it was enacted in 2009, and that has now been able to provide coverage to an additional 4 million children. Again, I'm not saying that the decisions the states are making are right or wrong. What I'm saying is that these decisions are being made, again, as a result of the changing demography of the United States, without many of us even realizing that these processes are unfolding. If we become informed and we decide this is what we want to happen, this is where our societal priorities are, and we make that as an informed decision, I think it's great. What I'm concerned is that we don't have an appreciation for what all these changes are. What about private sector insurance? What's going on there? Well, who does private sector insurance cover? Well, it covers employees. Makes sense. That's who is employed in the private sector. And it also covers their dependents. And this is the main way in which children get private insurance coverage, is as a dependent on a covered life for an employed person. Now, the trends in private insurance coverage are is an increasing focus and a priority on investment in disease management, mostly for adults. And to me, that makes a lot of sense, because employers want to keep their employees healthy. So it makes sense that they would have high blood pressure or type 1 diabetes disease management programs, because it keeps their workers healthy. To me, that's where investment for this kind of stuff makes sense that it would go. However, there's also been increasingly an erosion of private sector insurance offerings. Certainly in the state of Michigan, that's a big focus right now with the auto industry, but it happens across the board. However, one thing that is going on is, for all the talk of the importance of prevention in childhood and using childhood interventions to prevent adult diseases, That really hasn't caught on so much within the private sector, and there seems to be a disconnect right now, the way in which the insurance is structured, that there's an investment in disease prevention outside of immunizations in the childhood arena that could eventually ultimately impact adult disease. And again, it makes sense because employers would then be investing in future savings to which they would not necessarily have any direct benefit. But how is private insurance coverage paid for? Well, it's paid for by the employee. And the question is, what's the share that the employee pays for, both for their own coverage as well as for dependent coverage? Well, the employee, because we all know, just like at UNC or at Michigan or if I worked for Ford, I don't get all of my insurance for free. I have to pay a certain part of it. Well, overall, nationally, employees pay on average about 16% of the cost of their coverage. They pay 28% of the cost of dependent coverage. Again, just reminding you, this is where kids get private insurance. In the low-wage employee sector, employees pay, again, around 16% of the total cost of their coverage, but they pay 34% of dependent coverage. So one of the reasons we have underinsurance in the children's, in low-income children, is because of the higher requirement of the proportion of dependent coverage that low-wage workers have to pay. What about investment in research? Well, public investment often follows political pressure. That's certainly true at the NIH, where I can certainly tell you that the National Institute on Aging is doing really well relative to other institutes, and that there's a significant amount of political pressure to be able to increase funding for issues related to elders. Again, not saying that it's bad, not saying it's wrong. They're a greater proportion of our population. What we have to decide is, do we want to go down a path of proportional spending? And if we do, what do we do to that proportion of our society of children, again, that's shrinking, but with the absolute number of children not shrinking? We have investment at the CDC, and we also have investment in HRSA and a variety of other arenas. There's also private investment in research. And private investment, even in this difficult economic time, follows market pressures. Where does private capital go, besides to AIG? Private capital goes to areas of potential growth. That's where money goes. And as I showed you on those previous charts, growth is in the adult sector and in the elder sector. So increasingly, private investment, whether it be for devices, whether it be for drugs, is being targeted towards the adult community and to the elder community because that's the growth market. It makes sense. I mean, that's just the way the world works. But all I'm doing is just trying to illustrate what happens in the public sector, what happens in the private sector. So now that I've laid out to you what I think some of the issues are, let's talk about how we as a society value healthcare. And how do we decide what we're willing to pay for? Well, many of you in this room, I feel like I'm bringing coals to Newcastle. Many of you are health economists in this room. My advisor from my master's thesis is in this room. It's kind of bizarre. Just trying to make you proud, Dr. Biddle. That's right. Is that we have different mechanisms of how we value healthcare and how we value life in this country. Sometimes we try and think of this in terms of the cost per an additional life year. Sometimes we look at it in terms of societal priorities or philosophical issues. And sometimes we think about it in terms of the affluence of society. How much is society willing to pay for something? And has that changed over time? Are we willing to pay more for things today than we were 10 years ago? How does all that play out? It's a Calvin and Hobbes cartoon. It says, you can see it says at the end, it says, how can something seem so plausible at the time and so idiotic in retrospect? Because it's difficult. We can think, okay, yeah, it's easy. We can make these decisions and we can just look at things objectively, but it's really hard. And things don't always turn out as easily as they might otherwise. So just as a kind of a very simplistic, with my apologies to all of the health economists in the room, just a simplistic way of looking at the cost of an additional year of life. I'm going to show you a little graph trying to demonstrate the marginal effects of healthcare relative to marginal spending for the periods 1960 to the year 2000. We're going to look at a little life table to see how mortality rates have changed. And just for the sake of discussion, I'm assuming the proportion of improvement was due to medical care was 50%. I could have picked 10%. I could have picked 80%. It's really just for illustration, okay? And it would work out the same no matter what percentage I chose. So just looking at life expectancy. At birth, if you were born in 1960, you'd expect to live 69.9 years. If you're born in the year 2000, you're expecting to live 75.4 years. So there's a, just for those of you who are numeracy impaired, I think is the word, right? That's almost 6 years change in life expectancy if you were born in 60 or born in 2000. There's a little over, or right around a year difference if you were born in 1990 or 2000. If you're 65 years of age in 1960, you have 15.4 years left to go. If you're 65 years at the year 2000, you've got 18.2 years left to go. And then the difference between, say, if you were 65 in 1990 to 65 in 2000, you've picked up 0.3 years, okay? Simplistic life table. And if you assume the, again, half of the cost of the, or half of the benefit of those increases in life years was due to medical advances, you can see that the little green bars are 1960 to 2000, that bigger range, and then just for the last decade. And the cost per each additional life year that one would attribute to medical advances, again, the absolute numbers aren't what's key because I just made up 50%, but it's the proportions that you're seeing, that the cost per additional life year at birth is really pretty low because you're getting a bunch of extra life years. The cost for additional life year at age 65 is actually quite high because you're not gaining very many life years as a result of, well, number one, we haven't gained that many life years at that age range, and certainly from medical advances, it's a smaller fraction. So what I'm trying to illustrate is the cost per life year for a kid to add it on is really pretty small, or someone at birth, the cost to add it on at the end of life is actually quite high. So it's one way of looking at it, the cost per life year. Then sometimes we try and look at societal preferences. And this is one of those kind of classic things that happen in philosophy classes. Suppose a choice must be made between, or people who do decision analysis, one or the other. Suppose a choice has to be made between two medical programs. The programs cost the same, but there's only enough money for one. Program A is going to save 100 lives from disease that kill 20-year-olds. Program B will save 200 lives from diseases that kill 60-year-olds. Which program would you choose? I'm not asking anyone to raise their hands. It's just, again, an illustration of the kind of studies that people do to try and determine society's interest or what's society's preference. And not surprisingly, most people pick the ones that are going to save the younger years. Again, not surprising, the research on societal preferences really ends up showing that the public, including the elderly, assign a higher priority to health gains for youth. Sometimes that's because youth are going to live longer. They have a longer life expectancy. Sometimes people believe it's because they have an economically productive life in front of them, that they're going to be net payers into society, not just net takers out of society, or whatever the appropriate economic term would be. And then others also look at what's called the fairness or equity aspect of things, or the fair innings argument. It's been described in the literature, is that kids haven't had as much of a chance to live, and everyone deserves an opportunity for at least so many years of a productive life. The other thing that the research has shown is that the value of health has actually increased over time, meaning that society, that we're willing to pay more for a year of life, or more for healthcare and more for medical advances in this decade than we were the last decade. That when people ask, the willingness to pay actually increases over time as our society has become more and more affluent. We're willing to spend more money for future gain. That's important for kids, because we're talking future gain way out into the future. And it makes a real difference for children, because investments that are made in kids actually aren't going to be paying off sometimes for 60, 70, 80 years. If you save a child's life from dying of Haemophilus influenza B meningitis at 2 months of age, we're saving 75, 80 years into the future. But it also means that the paradox we have about discounting the value of years into the future is indeed a paradox, because traditionally we discount life years as we discount money. But we have, in this instance, we have society actually willing to pay more for life years into the future, not less for life into the future. And again, like I said, we treat it like money by discounting it. And the further into the future, the greater the discount. In most currently, traditionally, long-term looks at the benefits of life years gained. And I would posit that this does stack the deck against kids, because when we're discounting to the future and gains that are 50, 60, 70 years into the future, we're discounting many of those gains to almost nothing. And so then the question arises, is a child's life, the years from 60 to 70, worth as much as an adult's life from 60 to 70? In our current way of calculating, they're not. And for those of you who have an interest in this, I had an article in Health Affairs that tried to look at this in a more meaningful way than I'm able to give justice to right now. But it's something that I think we really have to begin to grapple with, and whether or not our traditional ways of examining the cost effectiveness of interventions across the generations really makes sense. So how can we modify some of these cost effectiveness analyses to reflect more accurately our society's valuation of health improvements by age? And the other question is, how does this modification affect the results and the conclusions of recently conducted cost effectiveness analyses of even vaccines targeted to young people? They'll look very different depending on how we set up those assumptions. So what are some ideas or the synthesis of some of these arguments currently going on in the literature about discounting and about how cost effectiveness analyses might be modified? We can consider that future gains could be weighted to reflect more society's increase over time in their willingness to pay for healthcare. And in fact, we have a greater willingness to pay for healthcare, and that is increasing over time. We also can think about whether or not we want to include net resource use as opposed to just net resource consumption with regard to establishing particular cost effectiveness thresholds. In essence, children will have years of productivity, very different in terms of seniors, and whether or not we want to be able to put in societal perspectives into many of these types of analyses. And then lastly, how we can begin to bring together the societal preferences for which there are data that younger life years actually receive priority over later life years for equity reasons. And like I said, the studies that have been done really reflect without question and almost in unanimity that societal preference. So right now it seems like that kids are the little rabbit when we're doing cost effectiveness analyses, because I believe the way the deck is stacked against them, but it doesn't necessarily always have to be that way. So we do have some challenges going forward: the challenges of demography, challenges of budgetary constraints, and in effect, competing interests. It's not bad, though. It's not bad that we have competing interests, and it's not bad we have challenges. To me, the real key is making transparent our societal priorities. We need to make decisions based on information, not just to let these processes unfold without us having a greater appreciation for what they are. I believe we also need to level the economic evaluation playing field. And as I'll speak about in a second, I think there's ways that we need to reform the Medicaid program. So we have different societal priorities that we need to work out. There's pros and cons to proportional spending. It's not necessarily a bad thing to spend a greater proportion of society's resources on a growing proportion of the population. And we need to figure out ways of balancing the needs of seniors and the needs of children. One aspect of need isn't greater or isn't more important than the other. They're both important. They're both necessary. The key is, how do we as a society decide how we're going to divvy the pie. And in terms of the economic arena, we need to figure out those fair methods of evaluation. I believe we need to cease penalizing long-term benefits of interventions and, at the same time, account for those future needs of our society. Now, how do we go forward in Medicaid? As I said, Medicaid is made up or covers three large groups: children, the disabled and the blind, and the elderly. Each of those are the big covered areas of the Medicaid program. So I posit and throw out for your consideration, what if we were to actually divide Medicaid into separate insurance programs, publicly funded, for those three separate programs? We'd be better able to link funding and expenditures. Because if there's a ballooning out of one of those arenas, we'd be able to know it much more cleanly, and we'd know which of those three eligibility categories is where our problem is, and maybe where we need to make those cutbacks, if in fact cutbacks were what we really wanted to do. Right now, we have one big pot of expenditures and one big pot of revenues that flow into the program, and no real accountability with regard to any aspect to match expenditures with those tax revenues or those the tax input into the program. If we were to separate them out, we'd be able to make very deliberate decisions about what we want to fund in Medicaid and to what level. Society would have a greater role in making those decisions. And we'd be able to and the other aspect of this is that, as I showed you, different states have different criteria, and that's one of the fundamental aspects of Medicaid and one of the fundamental aspects of immunization policy is this state variability and states getting to decide what they do and what they don't do. And, you know, I'm in the South, and certainly I believe in states' rights and all that kind of stuff while I'm here, but I do think that there's a limit to that, and I think that the fact that either a blind or disabled person has one benefit package in North Carolina, or a child has a benefit package in North Carolina, and just across the border from Person County, just north of here, how about that, Person County, in Virginia, has a different benefit package, isn't necessarily something that's likely in the best long-term interests of our society, and certainly in health, and especially as it pertains to easily with regard to childhood immunizations, where this is a communicable disease, epidemics don't stop at state borders, that one thing would be covered in one state and one not in another, really doesn't make good public health sense. So from a Medicaid standpoint, whether there should be some kind of baseline uniformity amongst a benefit package, and then secondly, whether or not we want to be able to consider breaking apart discreetly the budget and funding of the three different major eligibility categories. So it's a long road and a lot of data to come back to demography, and that we do have some challenges that are facing our nation. And these challenges are only going to get more acute as that initial graph that I showed you continues, and that divergence of the proportion of our population continues. And we have to deal with it. And we need to deal with it from an informed standpoint as opposed to, I believe, a passive standpoint. We're going to continue to have budgetary constraints, certainly much more so than we've had previously. And it's only going to get worse probably for the next couple of years before it gets better. We're going to have to make some really tough choices. And we have to realize that there are competing interests out there that are trying to affect those choices. And again, it's not bad we have competing interests. That's always going to happen. But I, again, perhaps naively, believe that a more informed citizenry, a more informed public health arena is going to help make better decisions. It's a Calvin and Hobbes cartoon that says, the more you know, the harder it is to take decisive action. Once you become informed, you start seeing complexities and shades of gray. You realize that nothing is clear and simple as it first appears, and ultimately knowledge is paralyzing. He throws his book away and he says, being a man of action, I can't afford to take that risk. He says, you're ignorant, but at least you act on it. I think the time for us and the convenience of being ignorant can no longer be the case. There are huge changes afoot right now in the way in which we're spending our healthcare resources in this country, beyond the debate about healthcare reform. And the generational or the age or the demographic of the aging of America is a process that is only going to continue and only to become more acute. The pressure points that I've been pointing out to you with regard to the budget are very real, and they're only going to continue. And it does have an impact, not just on Medicaid, not just on childhood immunization programs, but on a variety of different sectors. And it's all happening right now. And the difference is whether or not we're informed enough to know that proportional spending is taking place and the impact that it's having. It may be the right thing to do. We have to deal with a shrinking pool, but we need to understand the consequences of the current processes that are taking place. Because ultimately, we have some real hard decisions to make, and we need to figure out what we're going to do. And I'm hoping that the more informed we are, the better decisions we're going to make. So thank you for your attention.